So we have covered needs and three chapters of cognitions. And in cognitions, we have mindsets, goal setting, and self-control beliefs. So today we're going to talk about the last chapter about cognition. That's the self-striving. So you may wonder why we study the self and self-driving, because this class is about motivation and emotion. So how the self is associated with the two concepts. Actually, the self concept is closely associated with motivation and emotion, because some constructs about the self may act as a motive and also influence emotions. So in this chapter, we have four major topics. First one, defining and creating the self. Second one, discovering and developing personal potential. Next one is self-regulation and self-management. The last one is how the self is associated with or related to the society. So the self is not only the self, but the self can be related to the society, to others. And I found the author of this textbook disliked the concept of self-esteem. He talked about some issues with this concept. So what is self-esteem? It is a subjective evaluation of self-worth. So in other words, it's your personal sense that you are worthy or not worthy. So if you have a high self-esteem, you think yourself is worthy. If you think, if you have lower self-esteem, you think that yourself is not worthy. So that's self-esteem. So they'll ask questions about how do you feel about yourself. People with higher self-esteem will say, oh, I feel really good about myself. And people with low self-esteem will say that, oh, I do not feel good about myself. So that's self-esteem. There's a really serious problem with this concept. Self-esteem does not cause anything. So in other words, it's not antecedent to any other variables or constructs, but it's caused by many factors such as achievement and productivity. So basically means that if you are really productive, you gain a lot of achievement. Naturally, you have a higher self-esteem. But to have a higher self-esteem, it does not make you to have higher achievement and productivity. So the author described it as a scoreboard to report how well or how poorly things are going. So self-esteem is just like a scoreboard. It's a reflection of yourself. It's not the cause of yourself. So I would use the speed meter in the car as a metaphor. So a speed meter reflects how the engine performs, but does not cause the engine to perform or cause the performance of the engine. So when you drive, you can see the speed meter, right, in the glitter. So you know that the speed meter is just a reflection of the engine, of the speed of the car. So why car moves? Because of the petroleum and its engine, not because the movement, a needle movement of the speed meter, right? So if you want the car to be faster, you put off pedal, and so more petroleum will go to the engine and it will be faster. You wouldn't break the Gauss clicker and move the needle of the speed meter to make it faster, right? Do you understand me?
Yeah, I do.
So it's like a joke, but you don't laugh. So nobody would, so if you want to make the car faster, you wouldn't move the needle of the speed meter, because it doesn't work. Because that's the outcome of the speed of the engine performance. It's not the cause of the engine performance. So it's true for self-esteem. So self-esteem is like a speed meter of your own performance situation. So, but the self-esteem does not cause the change in the performance. So here is a, and also it makes people feel good. High self-esteem makes people feel good, but self-esteem itself does not motivate people. So does not serve as a motive. So here's a real example. In 1986, state of California decided to enhance students' self-esteem, because there's some research showing that high self-esteem is associated with higher academic achievements and better scores and free of drug abuse. So they decided to boost the students' self-esteem. They spent a lot of money in these programs that are designed to enhance students' self-esteem. But turned out that these programs were totally failure. So if you read the textbook, you can know this story. But I heard of this story before. Why these programs failed? Because they found that self-esteem did not change anything. So the consequences of these programs are that the students' self-esteems are really high, but they do not have a better score. They still behave the same way, except the higher self-esteem. So the state of California wasted tons of money, but it turned out that there was nothing happened after that. So that's a problem of self-esteem. So you may ask, what on earth can motivate people to behave? Self-concept is one of them. So self-concept is a set of beliefs an individual uses to conceptualize him or herself. So self-concept is just the concepts of the self. So there are concepts of others. So we have, because in our mind we know other people, we have concepts of our parents, our family, our friends. And it's true that we have concepts of ourselves. So self-concepts is a cluster of domain-specific self-schemas. So what are schemas, self-schemas? Self-schemas are cognitive representations or generalizations about the self. But self-schema, one self-schema is domain-specific. And also, people can learn, can build these self-schemas from past experiences. So, for example, for adolescents in high school, their self-schemas may include scholastic competence, physical appearance, peer acceptance, and of course, other parts of about themselves. So these are self-schemas. And combination of all the self-schemas is the self-concept. actually self-concepts or self-schemas can act as motives. Because why? Because with existing self-schemas, people actively seek out information that is consistent with their own self-schemas. So with these cognitive structures, they are motivated to find information from environments that is consistent with their own existing self-schemas. So that's how self-schemas can be the motives to sustain and to direct, to energize people's behaviors. And also, they will find a way to interact with those people who treat them in ways that are consistent with their own self-schemas. So let me give you an example. So first, for the first principle, so for example, I think I'm a person who should succeed. So I think I'm a successful person. So I'll actively find information that proves I succeed. So any successful experience, I will remember that, I'll find those information. But some information shows I fail, I'll ignore that. I'll not pay attention to those information. I will not actively find those information. So it turns out that if you ask me whether you are a successful man or not, I will say yes, because the information, all I know is, it shows that I must succeed all the time. But in reality, it may not be true, because every person succeeds and fails. But with the self-schemas that I'm a successful man, I always actively seek out the information that proves I'm successful. And for the second principle, is also similar, so a similar logic applies. So I would choose to hang out with people who will say, oh, you are successful. I'm sure you are successful. You will succeed all the time. So I'll choose to hang out with people who say that. So those people give me information that is consistent with my own self-schemas. So I will not choose to interact with people who will say you will fail. Here's your failure. I will not choose to interact with people who say those things. So that's how the self-concept, self-schemas motivate people. So you may ask, what if some information is not consistent with your self-schemas? That's really possible, because you do not really get the information you want to get. So that involves a self-verification crisis and may change the self-concept. So this graph from the textbook shows how self-concept can be changed. So up here it says people prefer to receive feedback from others that confirm their pre-existing self-view. So they just find information that is consistent with their own self-schemas. And so the activists seek out the information that is consistent with their self-schema. So they try to verify their pre-existing self-view. But what if they get some information, some feedback that is not consistent or self-discrepant with their own self-schemas? Something happens. So there are three situations. The first situation is that the self-concept certainty is really high. Means that they are really certain, they are really confident, they are this kind of person. So when the certainty is high, the self-discrepant feedback, the inconsistent information will be ignored by them. So their self-schemas do not change. So when the self-concept certainty is moderate, so they are kind of sure but not really sure about their own self-concept, so there's a self-verification crisis. So they doubt about their own self-schemas because they get some inconsistent information from outside. So they kind of hesitate whether I'm a person like this or not. So they go to this situation, the self-concept certainty is low, so they are not sure what the self is. So they want to seek out some additional feedback to see whether they are this kind of person or not this kind of person. So when this happens, they doubt about themselves, seek out additional feedbacks. What if the feedback proves that their pre-existing self-schemas are right? They do not change their self-concept because other information show that they are like this. So their self-concept certainty increases. But what if the additional social feedback is still not consistent with their own self-schemas? They may change their self-concept or change some of their self-schemas. So they go through all of this process to change their self-concept or self-schemas. That's how the self-concepts can be changed. So from this conclusion, this findings, it provides a huge implication that if you think what you are, that self-concept will influence your attention, your behavior. So if you think what you are, you will finally be what you think you are. So if you think you are a successful person, you will succeed eventually. But if you think you are a person who failed, you are a failed person, you'll fail eventually.
You're setting yourself up for that.
Huh?
You're setting yourself up for that by thinking that you're going to fail.
What is that?
You're setting yourself up for failure by thinking that you're going to fail.
Yeah. So your self-concept will influence your behavior and influence the final outcomes. Because, take the example of success and failure. If you think you are a successful person, you will seek out information that proves you are successful. And if you think you are a person who, if you think you are a person who fails, you always seek out information that is that shows that you fail. Always, you will ignore the information about your success. You will always remember the information about your failure. And also, self-schemas can act as a goal, like a goal. Because in the self-concept, there is a present self. So present self represents your knowledge about your current self, what you are currently. That's a present self. Also, there is a future self or possible selves. Possible selves represent ideas of what people would like to become in the future, and what they are afraid of they might become in the future. So possible selves are not about the current moment, but about the future. There is a broad picture in the future about yourself. You want to be like that. And so it's there, it's a, like a destination, it's like a goal. You want to go there, so you involve in some kind of a journeys. So it's like a traveling, you have a destination and here's your track, your trip. So you gradually move from the present self to the possible self, to the future self. It's like this. Here's your present self. So here's your possible self. Here, the present self is where you are. The possible self is you, where you want to get. So what you do is you move yourself, you try hard to go through this path to the possible self. So possible self is like a goal. So in the chapter of goal setting, we have known that the goal is a desired outcome that you want to get. So so possible self is also like a goal. So motivate individuals to behave, to try hard to move from the present self to the future self. So especially when positive feedbacks confirm their efforts, they will try harder. But if the if there are negative feedbacks, they may abandon the possible self. They may build another possible self. So they have a new destination if the negative feedback is too strong. So that's how self-concept or self-schemas can motivate people. The first way is to find information that is consistent with the self. And the second way is to go to the possible self, to become what they want to be, to go to the possible self. And more about this part. So how do you rationalize people's behaviors to seek the consistent self? How do you explain that? Why they want to actively seek out information that is consistent with their own self-schemes? Do you have ideas?
Makes them feel good.
Huh?
Makes them feel good.
Why they feel good if information is consistent with their own self-schemas?
I guess it reinforces what they already believe. Like, they don't want to be challenged. I guess those kind of people, they don't want to be challenged by other types of information. Or it's like, I forget the exact term, but basically, like, if there's information that is not consistent with their schema, I guess they'll come up with excuses or with other reasons as to why it's not consistent with its schema.
Yeah, so because this part reminds me of cognitive dissonance. So we have learned the cognitive dissonance in mindset chapter, right? So when there are conflicting information coming in our mind, so the information is conflicting each other, so there will be dissonance. So that we are motivated to reduce the distance. So how do we reduce the distance? On the one side is self-concept. On the other side is information from the outside. So we either change the self-concept or change the information or ignore the information from the outside. So look at this part. We choose to pay attention, pay attention to the information that is consistent with the self-concept. So that's a strategy to reduce the distance, or it's a strategy to avoid some possible distance, right? So if there is inconsistent information coming in, we choose to ignore it because we do not want to have the distance. We want to reduce the distance. It's a strategy to reduce the distance. Or we just only pay attention to the information that is consistent with the self-concept. So you can explain this through cognitive distance theory. So through the self-verification process, you may change your self-concept. If the negative or inconsistent information is too strong, you may change your self-concept. It's also a strategy to reduce the distance, because you cannot change the information so that you change your own self-concept, so the distance can be reduced. So that's how the self-concept can act as a motive. The next part is agency. So agency is also a self-concept or so. So it's not only the cognitive part of self-concept, it's a self-concept combined with some motivational properties. So that's agency. Agency is a view of self as action and development from within. So it's an innate process and also motivation. So what does that mean? So you can understand agency as a feeling that people feel that they themselves can be the origin of the change in the environment. They feel that they can do something to change the outcome from environment. They can do something to change themselves. They can do something to change the situations. So the self can be the recipient, passive recipient, all of the outcomes from the environment. Also, they can understand themselves, their self, as some active thing that can change something to happen. It can be the cause, not only the outcome. So that's the agency. It's actually a subjective feeling about the self. So agency also acts as a motivation, as motive. It's a source of motivation. With the agentic self, agentic sense of self, people energize, people pursue their interests, seek out challenges, develop their talents, and build more relationships with others. They develop more identities, more social roles, develop more skills. Why they do that? Because they believe they can do that, so that they do that. So imagine that if they do not have an agentic sense of self, they do not think they can change anything, so that they do nothing. They do not seek out, pursue their interests, because they think that they cannot do that. They do not challenge themselves. They do not build social relationships with others. So agency is really important property in people's mind to grow grow properly, to prosper, to flourish. So that's how, with agency, with agentic view of the self, their self-concept can develop, can change all the time. So self-concept is not a static, is not a fixed, it's not like the same over time. Rather, self-concept is always changing, it's dynamic. So the self-concept becomes more, can be become more complex through the process called differentiation. So as they grow, as they pursue their interests, build a relationship with others, their self-concepts incorporates more interests, more relationships, more identities, more talents, more skills, more roles, more positions in the society. So that's how the self-concept, their self-concept is more complex. So imagine that a newborn baby, the newborn baby knows nothing, has no relationships with others, has no interests, has no talents, has no skills. But gradually the baby will grow. So their concept, his or her concept, will be more complex, because the baby is continues exploring the environment, continue growing his or her skills or talents. So as a result, their self-concepts become more and more and more complex. So this process is called differentiation. At the same time, their self-concepts become more coherent, because there are more parts, and there's a natural tendency that they integrate all the parts into a coherent unit. So they become more coherent. There are more connections among these different parts. So this process is integration. So every person thinks that he or she is he or she, him or herself, right? So for example, I think I'm a David. I do not think I'm a David, also Peter, also Benjamin, also other people. Because my self-concept is coherent. I integrate all these parts together into David. So the self-concepts do not fall apart, but they are coherent. But I also myself, I think myself is relatively complex. So the process of growing, changing the self-concept, is also the process of internalization. So this process or this concept we have mentioned in the chapter 6, the psychological needs, but I will recap here. It's a process through which individuals transform a previous externally prescribed way of behaving or valuing into an internal process, internal way of behaving or valuing. So how to understand that? At the beginning, if you are a newborn baby, you know nothing, you have no relationship with others, you have no interests, no talents, no skills, no identities. But gradually, you find some activities are interesting. So these activities used to be some external things for you as a newborn baby. So some you build some relationships with others, but these people, these relationships used to be the external sources of influence for you, but you internalize them into your self-concept, right? Here's an example, not from a newborn baby, but from the, imagine you are a worker in a company, and the manager will assign you some jobs, some tasks to do, right? You, as you were in your position, but you found that these tasks really boring. the work you do is really, really boring for you. So at this time, you do not internalize the tasks to your concept. But the manager knows that and talks about it with you and provides the rationales, provides the meaning doing this task. And right now you find that this task is still boring for you, but this task is kind of meaningful to yourself, because doing this task can improve your skills and important for your future career. And also this task is beneficial to others. Your work, the job you do is beneficial to others, is meaningful to others. So it's actually, if you know from the chapter 6, it's a process of it's one way of autonomy support, right? Providing the rationales or meaning to this task. So you used to be introjected, regulated, or externally regulated to do the task. Now you know it's meaningful. This task is meaningful. You evolve in identified regulation. So actually it shifts from more controlled motivation to more autonomous motivation. Although all these are extrinsic motivation, but identified regulation is better than the external or introjected regulation. It's more autonomous. So this process is one example of internalization. So this task, these things used to be boring for you, used to be meaningless for you, but you internalize them. You think this task, oh, it's kind of interesting, or this task is kind of important for you, or this task reflects your values. Okay. So that's called internalization. So people, no matter they are newborn babies or no matter they are adults, they are old adults, they internalize some external activities or some external values into their own self-concept. Here's some implications. Humans possess a core self through internalization. So there is a part that is core for your self-concept. So this core does not change. Actually, it's growing, it's changing. I'm wrong. So it's growing, it's changing. But there's a core part that is really stable. But it shows us not all the self-structures, not the things in your concepts are consistent or congruent with the core self. So for example, you yourself are interested in music or art. You want to be an artist. But your current position is to do the data analysis job. So because you find a data analysis job, you are a data analyst. So being a data analyst is a part of your self-concept. It's your identity, it's your position. But this part, being a data analyst, is always conflicting or not congruent with the core self. Because in your core self, you want to be an artist. So if there are self-structures are not congruent with the self, core self, what will happen? There will be constant inner conflicts. So you gotta be to do the data analysis job, but you do not want to do that. You want to be an artist. So as a result, you are kind of motivated to do the data analysis job, but the other part of yourself, your core self, tells you do not do that, to be an artist. But the position, the other parts of the self tells you that, oh, you gotta be do the data analysis job. because you are that, you are in that position. You need to have a salary to support your life. So there are sounds from the two sources that create a conflict.
Question.
Yeah.
So if you pursue both,
yeah, what do you mean by doing both?
Meaning if you have the inner desire to be an artist or do music, you're doing it but not full artist, but you're putting a part of yourself into the artistic side of your being, and then you're feeling your want to be.
Okay, so it means that
the conflict, or is the conflict still there because you're not full-heartedly pursuing the artistic side?
So I would think that if you do a data analysis job in the daytime, like 8 hours a day, and the rest of the time you're doing some artist work, it's better because in the rest of the time you're pursuing something that is consistent with your core self. But when you're doing the data analysis job, there's still a conflict. So the conflict does not disappear. It's always there. If the something you do is not consistent with your core self. Yeah.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, so let's continue this on Wednesday, and also remember to post questions.